I'm born in 1951 in Israel. My father was a refugee, 70 years old, alone, came to Palestine before the Second World War. And my mother came to Palestine as 15 years old from Poland before the war. So I was born after the establishment of Israeli state. My parents were very left wings. They were a member of Communist Party. I'm grown up in a kibbutz. It's a kind of a collective form of village. And as all Israelis, when I was 18, I went to the military service. I was a paratrooper in the Israeli army 3 years. And in 1970, I refused to serve in occupied territories because I said, as a soldier, I am ready to defend my country, but I'm not ready to be a police in the civilian areas with civilian population. I have not trained for this. I'm trained to war with other soldiers, not with civilians. I was in prison for a while, then I went back to the service, and when I finished my military service, I left Israel not to live forever, just to see the world. I was a while in Germany, a while in Denmark, I went to Sweden, I went back to Israel, and in 1973, in September 1973, it's exact 40 years ago, I came to Sweden, and after some years, I came into the music academy. I studied 8 years music and composition and saxophone, and I stayed in Sweden. So now I live in Sweden 30 years as a musician and composer and artist and political activist. Everyone thought I would be a mathematician or some other things with physics or with chemistry because I was good in mathematics in school. I think I always want to be a revolutionary because this was my kind of upbringing. I had ambitions to do something that will change the world. It sounds very childish, but I was a child. There is a very famous poem from an Israeli Jewish poet called Shaul Chernichovsky that says that the human being is the landscape of its childhood. So for me, I am born in Israel. I've spent my first 22 years there. I can close my eyes and imagine the smell of the air of Israel. I know the name of all the flowers and the grass. And it is part of my identity. But now I have been 40 years in Sweden, so If you ask me if I am a Swedish composer or Israeli composer, I say I am a Swedish composer. I left Israel because I wanted. So I don't feel as a refugee. I went to Sweden to visit friends and then I stayed. But now I cannot go back to Israel. I'm forbidden to enter Israel. And because of this, this gives me a feeling I am kind of a refugee. But as a matter of fact, I don't feel. I feel like I'm a Swedish living in Sweden. Music, tones, rhythms, they are they are apolitical by themselves. But musical structures and musical connotation can be political. It depends how you put them together. When I speak about music and politics, I am thinking always about D'Alembert. D'Alembert was the editor of the first encyclopedia in France. And in 1752, he wrote a little book called About Freedom of Music. And there he said, all forms of freedom are bound together. The freedom of music starts the freedom of the feeling, starts the freedom of the thinking, and starts the freedom of the acting. And the freedom of the acting is enemy number one of the state. So if you want to keep the monarchy, don't change the form of the opera. If you start to question how music should sound, then there's no stop. Next time you ask why the bus is standing there and not there, why you have the road here destroying the Donau's part of Budapest, and next you will ask why it should be like this, and then you will try to do something. I mean, when you start to question the order of things, and the different hierarchies of the things in music, then why not in society too? So I think this will to reach freedom in music can lead to reach freedom in the real life too. I didn't play before I came to Sweden. When I came to Sweden, I played a little bit clarinet, but really nothing. And in Sweden, I somehow heard some records with Frank Zappa and John Mayle. And I listened to Ian Anderson that play saxophone by Frank Zappa group and some saxophonists by John Mayle. And I like the instrument and I like the difficulty in blowing it, because if you don't play, it seems very difficult to do. So I decide I will buy a saxophone. So I bought a saxophone without knowing what I'm going through, what I'm going into. And I just try to play and I liked it. I have from Soprillo, that's even smaller than Sopranino. And I have contrabass saxophone too. Here I have today with me, I have Sopranino, Alto and Tenor. I would say like this, I would call the composition for tonight, music is castrated noise. For me, music is organized noise. You know, noise is like a sculpture. Like you have a stone, and then you take and you put it away, what you don't want to have inside. So if you want to have a flower from the stone, you make it to flower, but it's still the stone. If you make a portrait, it's a portrait. The same with music. I can take with noise. I can take everything, then we have a single melody. But it is out of the noise. We take away all the slug out, and then we have the noise, the one single noise left. So tonight we will have a noisy concert. Silence nearly never exists. I made experiment after I was in prison in Israel. I was 23 days in isolation. And it was very silent, but it was never silent. When I came to Sweden, when I studied composition, I decided I will make experiments. So I went into a total isolated room in the technical high school, in the acoustic department. So there was totally no sounds. But after like 1 minute, you start to hear your stomach, you hear your heart, and I think I heard a very, very high tone that the people said it's the brain. I don't know if I heard it or it was my fantasy, but still, there was no silence. So I don't believe silence exists in reality, maybe in space. But I think that we can create silence in ourselves. And this is the important thing. How can we create silence in ourselves? Not like kind of trying to take away all the audio impressions around us. And this, of course, as a musician, it's very nice sometimes. But sometimes I like to hear sounds. In the Passion of St. Matthew by Bach, there is one of the arias called Aus Liebe. And this aria, the tempo is given exactly like your heartbeat. This is, for me, the core of tempo in music, the aria Aus Liebe from Bach. Because I think he, in this composition that is 3 hours long, he is really working with tempo, with dynamic. For me, this is the tempo. Of the music. I made a composition once that for solo violin, there was a microphone here on the heart of the musician. It was a very difficult piece, and this was his click track. So the harder he play, the quicker his heart going, the quicker he have to play. If I compose for orchestras, if I compose contemporary music, then I compose with computer. When I compose for melodies or more for improvised music, I compose more by playing saxophone. But usually when I play improvised music, I don't compose at all. I like to go to stage with unprepared. I like to go on stage with not knowing what will happen. Because I believe that if you are good enough in listening, and if you are good enough in playing, then you can create a very interesting musical conversation. In the same way that when we meet somebody we don't know in the street, we can sit in a cafe and speak with this person. We don't have to have a manus, we don't have to have a score. It depends on how we listen and how our fantasy works. I will play tonight with a musician I never met before. I made a CD together with my group, Locomotive Concrete, called A Voice Still Heard. And I make this, I wrote melodies based on the research I make about Jewish praying tradition. And I like very much the more slowly going Jewish melodies, more sad ones. I don't like so much klezmer, and I don't like so much the American Jewish jazz scene, because I think that, unfortunately, it's very much nationalistic and pro-Zionistic, and for me, it's a very conservative thing. You know, to make music like in Ornette Coleman style and have some Orientalic scales or Jewish scales, it's not making it Jewish at all.